Hey everyone, Mac Murdoch here with OPT, and in today's video, we're going to be diving into camera specs and why they matter. We started with the basics of it in the ASI 2600 versus 1600 video, but we felt that the information is just so important that it deserved its own video and needed to be expanded upon. So here we are. Feel free to go to any of the timestamps right over here to jump to a specific target, but we do recommend that you stay for the whole thing because you never know if there's any fun facts that you might have not known. Something to keep in mind, most of this applies for DSLR and mirrorless cameras, not just Astro cameras. But before we dive in, let's go over the most important thing about cameras, smashing that like button. Without smashing the like button, your image quality will suffer, and we don't want you to suffer, so go ahead, smash that like button. Okay, so let's first talk about sensor sizes. The reflective thingamajigger inside of the camera is the sensor, and it comes in so many different shapes and sizes. When it comes to sensors, size matters, depending on what you're shooting. A few main sensor sizes are the Micro Four Thirds, like the ASI 1600, the APS-C size sensor, like the ASI 2600, and the full frame, like the ASI 6200. With a bigger sensor, you have the advantage of a bigger resolution due to more pixels on the sensor. You also have the advantage of having a bigger field of view. For example, here's an image and what it would look like on the three different sensors. So in essence, the bigger the sensor, the more space you get. This can come in handy when capturing really big objects in the sky and need more of a field of view. That being said, sometimes having a bigger sensor is not optimal for what you're trying to shoot. First of all, large sensors, like the full frame or bigger, can really test the limits of some entry-level telescopes. Full frame sensors are usually best when paired with larger telescopes that can support that size. Second, you may not want such a large field of view. For example, when you're shooting planetary, planets are so small that you don't need all that dead space around them. So you don't need to capture them with a large or even a medium-sized sensor. So having a small sensor like the ASI 174 or the ASI 290 is best for planetary. Especially because with a smaller sensor, you're capturing smaller files with less information, allowing you to take faster frames per second, which really comes in handy for things like planetary, lunar, or solar photography, which we'll get to in just a minute. Next, let's talk about pixel size. This is the size of the pixels on your sensor. Going with a bigger or smaller pixel size depends on a few things. Whichever one you choose is really just based off preference and what kind of objects you're trying to shoot. Cameras with smaller pixels mean that you have a lot more pixels on the sensor, giving you a much finer resolution and crisper detail in your images. But the trade-off is that you're not picking up as much light. And the opposite can be said about bigger pixels. Your pixels are more sensitive to light, but you sacrifice some resolution. Now, this is just my opinion and it's relative, but I'd say 3 microns and under is a small pixel. Anything from 3 to 5 microns is a mid-sized pixel, and anything above 5 microns is a large pixel. Things to note, if you're doing something like planetary, lunar, or solar, these objects are so bright as it is. So trading the sensitivity of a bigger pixel for a smaller pixel with better resolution is my personal preference. That's why the ASI 174, 290, and 120 are great. Now, there is a term called pixel binning, which to simplify it is basically combining pixels together to give you a bigger pixel, kinda, but we'll cover that in a different video. Now, the number of pixels that make up the length and width of the sensor is called the pixel array. For example, the ASI 2600 has 6,248 pixels on its long side and 4,176 pixels on its short side. Now, if you multiply 6,248 by 4,176, you get 26 million pixels on your sensor. In other words, 26 megapixels. Also, it's important and worth noting that the size of your sensor from one corner to the opposite corner is your sensor diagonal. The reason why this is so important to know is because it tells you what image circle you need your telescope to support and the smallest size filter that you can have. For example, with a Micro Four Thirds size sensor, which has around a 23 millimeter diagonal, we recommend going no smaller than 1.25 inch filters. With APS-C size sensors, which has a 29 millimeter diagonal, we recommend going no smaller than 36 millimeter filters. And with a full frame sensor, which has around a 43 millimeter diagonal, we recommend going no smaller than a 2-inch filter. A big choice that you have to make next is whether you want to go color or mono. I won't dive too far into this video on that because we've dedicated a whole video on its own that you can check out right here going over all of its pros and cons. But a quick glance over is that color cameras have mono sensors, but with little RGB filters placed on the sensor itself in a series called the Bayer matrix. On the other hand, we have mono cameras, which means that you have to have color filters to produce a full color image. This also means that more time will be dedicated to your imaging sessions, since you will need to take more exposures to produce a full color image. That being said, you're not dividing the pixels into three different colors like you are with a color camera. Instead, the whole sensor is dedicated to one filter, giving you more data and resolution. Next up, we have cooled and uncooled cameras. This one's pretty simple. When a camera heats up, so does the sensor and electronics. This creates small imperfections in how the camera runs, producing what we all know as noise. A cooled camera has a built-in fan that cools down your sensor and electronics, reducing the amount of noise in your image. Now let's talk about bit depth. Bit depth, in simplified terms, is the number of shades of gray from pure black to pure white. Now I know what you're thinking, but what if I'm shooting with a color camera? Well, shades of gray translates into color. Technically, all sensors are monochrome sensors recording gray, just different shades of it depending on what filter you're using. Let's break it down. 8-bit depth gives you only 256 shades of gray on each possible RGB channel. When stacked, this gives you 16.7 million colors to choose from, which might sound like a lot, but it's not compared to the cameras that we have out today. 10-bit can do 1,024 shades on each RGB channel, which comes out to over 1 billion colors. The 12-bit depth can do 4,096 on each channel, which comes out to 68 billion possible colors. 14-bit depth, which can do 16,384 shades on each channel, which comes out to 4.39 trillion possible colors. And finally, a 16-bit depth at 65,500 shades of gray per channel, which when combined gives you a full color image of 281 trillion colors. The more shades of gray that you have from black and white not only means more color in your image, but it also means smoother transitions between colors, which is important when capturing beautiful gradients in space. You can see here how 8-bit Mario smashes the like button. But when we have a much better 64-bit Mario smashing the like button, the difference is incredible. All right, so let's talk about full well depth. Full well depth is not too much different from bit depth, but it's also not the same. The full well depth is basically the amount of electrons of light that can fill each pixel before the pixel fills up and becomes full white. So a deeper full well depth will stop you from blowing out your image faster when your pixel well is full. Those extra photons spill into the pixels beside it, which is called blooming. It looks like bloated and overexposed stars. If you fill up that pixel well, you have blown out that pixel, leaving you no color data. Having a deeper full well depth will help you preserve your star colors as well as not blow out the really bright parts of your image like the core of galaxies. With a bigger bit depth and a deeper full well depth, you get much bigger dynamic range. The bigger the dynamic range, the better your final images will be. Next, we have back-illuminated sensors. These are a relatively new addition to the astral world within the last few years. This helps reduce noise, improves quantum efficiency, which we'll get to in a second, and eliminates amp glow. Most cameras come with a back-illuminated sensor these days, which is so nice. Another really important spec of picking out a camera is what's known as quantum efficiency, also known as QE. This is the percentage of light that hits the sensor and gets recorded as signal. Sensors aren't perfect and they can't pick up 100% of the light, even though that'd be so dope. So sensors like the ASI 2600, for example, has a 91% quantum efficiency, which means 91% of the light that's coming down the barrel of your telescope is getting recorded as actual data, and the other 9% gets sucked into the camera's black hole, never to be seen again. Camera sensors have been improving over time. Amazing top-notch cameras like the ASI 1600, maybe three-ish years ago, only had a 60% QE. So I know this goes without saying, but the higher the quantum efficiency, the brighter the image and the more data that you have in less time. Depending on the type of imaging you're going to be doing, frame rate is something you might want to consider. If you're doing something like long exposure photography of deep space objects, then you don't really need to worry about frame rate. But if you're going to be getting into solar or shooting the moon or capturing planets, then frame rate becomes so important. When you're shooting images like the moon, planets, or the sun, many photographers use a technique called lucky imaging, which we'll make a whole step-by-step video in the future about it, so subscribe. But for this video, it's basically taking a video of your target at a high frame rate, and then with the help of other programs, extracting the best and clearest frames from your video, and then stacking all those frames into one single image. Instead of taking 10 individual photos over 2 seconds, you can take 500 frames in 2 seconds. With almost every camera, you can increase the frame rate by cropping in on your sensor before you start capturing your image. A smaller sensor equals smaller data equals the ability to shoot even faster. Cameras like the ASI 174, the ASI 120, and the ASI 183 have really high frame rates, which make them perfect cameras for lunar, solar, and planetary. Which brings us to our next spec, USB 3. Now, this doesn't mean as much with deep space as it does with planetary, lunar, and solar, but the transfer speed of a USB is always welcome. This more comes in handy when we're talking about frame rate. If your camera is taking 300 frames per second, you're gonna need a fast cable and input to transfer that data without buffering. Now that's the main difference between the ZWO standard and the Mini Sidekick. To answer the question that we get all the time, the mini cameras make amazing guide cameras, but due to the lack of USB 3, it doesn't make it the best high frame rate imaging camera. The standard, on the other hand, has USB 3, making it perfect for both guiding and high-speed imaging. Well, there you have it, the in-depth look into the specs of a camera. Hopefully, this should help you find what you're looking for in future purchases. Now, keep in mind, the majority of these specs work with both cameras, DSLR and Astrocams alike. If you've enjoyed this video and you found it informative, or at least entertaining, please consider smashing the like button like the Hulk. It does really help with the channel and it recommends it to other people. Now, if you like the content, please consider hitting the subscribe button and leave us a comment at the bottom. Let us know what you want to see. My name is Mac Murdoch here with OPT, and thanks for watching. Clear skies.